Hi, my name's Rohan, and this is a great party. I'm enjoying it so much already. It's great to be here. Thanks so much to Soren and his team and Alfred and all the people here at Google for having me. And I was invited to talk about mindfulness technology and the future of mindfulness technology, and I thought that's such a big topic. So there's just so much to say, so what shall I say? So I thought today I'd talk about toxic material, food labeling, and design. But I'm going to start here. So 7 years ago today, pretty much today, give or take a couple of weeks, I was here. This is Wat Pa Nanachat. It's a monastery in northeast Thailand. It's quite famous in a certain tradition. And it's a pretty hardcore, this is like the busiest part of it. that's only partially a joke. And it's a pretty hardcore place. If you want to stay there for more than 3 days, you've got to shave your head, including your eyebrows. It's a 3 a.m. wake up, and there's one meal a day. So it's pretty intense. And nothing tests your equanimity practice like standing on a pile of fire ants in the middle of the night in your bare feet. So it was a really interesting time. And I was there as part of a six-month practice sabbatical I was doing out in across Asia in Thailand, Sri Lanka, and Burma. At the time, I was working for a big tech consulting firm in London, and it was very typical that after spending 5 or 6 years in that company to take some time out, and this is what I was doing. And it was a really amazing time. I was learning an incredible amount, all sorts of different things, different styles, different traditions, and so on. And I was very drawn to the beauty of the traditions I was practicing in. And when I came back to London, or even before I came back, I had a choice to make, which was basically I was very called to this traditional monastic path, and so I was very much exploring the idea of what would that look like for me, and was really close to committing myself to a monastic or pseudo monastic training, to be a full time meditator, whether it was within or without the monastic tradition was didn't make too much of a difference at the time, but on the other side of the path, or the other path, the other option I had was to still have the intensity and intention for my own personal practice and training and development, but to do it in a much less well-articulated way in the messiness of this, in my urban, digital, relational, social life. I chose the latter, and I chose the latter because and I continue to choose the latter because I'm interested in design, and I'm going to explain sort of what I've been discovering along the way of that, and sort of switch it up a bit. In this whole conversation, so as someone who makes sort of mindfulness apps and mindfulness related stuff, people always ask me, oh, this whole has mindfulness got anything to do with technology? Shouldn't we just turn everything off and then it'll be fine? And this idea, the idea behind that question, which comes up a lot, is summarized in this idea of the digital detox, which is becoming more and more common. We're seeing sort of all sorts of stuff around it. This idea of turning off your devices and taking away. And I think for me, I've always had a big problem with the idea of a digital detox because it frames technology as toxic. And that's, for me, is really problematic because it means we're spending all our time with something that actually, in a way, we consider as toxic. That language isn't really working for me. And as someone who's worked in and around technology, and many of you, technology is not the problem. Bad technology is the problem. So I'll sort of try and unpack this a bit. So the popular narrative is all around, Rohan, all this technology, like mindfulness apps are all very well and nice, but it distracts us, it pulls us, our attention's all over the place, we're fragmented, our concentration spans are going down the toilet and all this sort of stuff. And the problem is, like, all of that is true, but that's not intrinsic to technology. It's how we've made it. And it's all happened on our watch. And so, because at the center of, I'm going to make some big generalizations. It's a very short talk and it's an enormous topic. So forgive me, but I think at the heart of let's call it sort of the conventional web experience, it's very much around, it's built around distraction. So much of how revenue works on the web nowadays is through advertising, and that by definition is about distraction. Hey, I'm looking at this thing over here, but actually, if you look over here and click this, then I get paid. So, and that's sort of where our attention is being held hostage by a lot of our technology. And that's just how it's been designed. So I think we need to sort of recognize that. And also importantly in my critique of the detox is that it's not going away. This stuff, I don't know if you've noticed, but this technology stuff is not going away. So it's a really beautiful thing to take some time away from it. And in the short term, there's incredible benefit to that. But that is not a long-term solution to this problem for either us as individuals or as a society. So this is sort of the big challenge and the big idea behind this talk and a lot of the work I'm doing is that whilst retreating it has a lot of value to it and the detox has a lot of value to it, ultimately, we need to redesign our technologies. We need to think about how we make our technologies and what the impact of them are and sort of work at the core of them. Because in a way, the question I faced in Wat Pa Nanachar of like, do I enter a full-time retreat style life or do I go back into my work life is not dissimilar. Because if you think of a detox, it's a renuncia act. And like I said, there's a lot of beauty to that, but it's not necessarily the answer of the long-term answer. So as somebody who thinks a lot about design and in products and also in general, what would it be like if we placed awareness, calm, compassion, balance as specific design objectives in our digital products and our digital experiences and services? So that's the way by which we're measuring and making a work. And so what would it be like if our messaging services, our social networking services are explicitly designed at root to support kindness and compassion? What would it be like if our devices, our physical devices, our phones and our tablets were designed to remind us that we actually have a body? What would that actually be like? And I think these are the sort of questions that I'm thinking about. And the good news is that there are a lot of, I'm really, really, like, I'm a techno-optimist with regards to mindfulness and technology. I sort of have to be because I put a massive gamble on it myself, put a massive bet on it. But there's a community of people working in this kind of way of asking this question, and like whether it's in software and hardware, in social networking, in device design, in experience design, this idea of baking in all the values that have brought us here to Dublin to explore in such a way that we can live in a world where our devices are devices of well-being and not of distraction. And that's a really important movement, because otherwise, if we continue to relate to our technologies with this attitude of pathology or considering them as toxic, then that's not the future, the technology future that any of us here wants to build. And so to make that, we need everyone involved in the system. So that's designers, makers, developers, investors, consumers, to prioritize these kind of things, so that every interaction we have with a piece of software, an app, or a device, is an opportunity for practice. And I'm not just talking about mindfulness apps or mind training headsets. They're very specific types of thing. I'm talking about everything. And this is sort of the big challenge and the big challenging idea around, can we make every interaction, what is it? What would that be like for every interaction with every piece of technology to be supportive of us as human beings? And that's a really, for me, that's when Vision was taking us through that lovely visualization, it was that sort of, that big idea and vision that I was really connecting with. And I said, like I said, I am a techno optimist, but I'm not an idiot. and I know this is a niche view, but well, like I said, I feel I feel like I'm part of a community. I'm in constant contact with entrepreneurs and startups, and increasingly investors who are interested in these kind of metrics and these kind of outcomes. Because whilst this is definitely a niche view at the moment, and if sort of mindfulness is a niche or a mega niche right now, this is like a sort of the niche of the niche. But then I study niches, and the movements I've really looked at in the last 6 months have been around organic food and fair trade food and products. And what I was sort of really interested in this idea of what changed sort of 40 years ago, what, and 40 and 30 years ago, what changed these really sort of quite niche sort of hippie points of view into actually a genuine market, a proper market with proper billions of dollars against them. And ultimately just comes down to consumers. So us as consumers have to start to placing value on this and start to say, actually, there's a point at which it's not okay that every comment feed I read on an article is actually making my blood boil and actually supporting my anger. So the next couple of slides are sort of a sort of thought experiment. What would it be like if we had the skills, the information, the user consumer demand that as much as we now are fully aware of what we put into our bodies and we have the information as consumers to make an informed decision, okay, this sandwich has this certain amount of stuff, and actually, yeah. And like, so if that information is important to you, you'll make that decision around that information. We have the information now. We have the technology to make the type of information around our digital experiences so that we as consumers can go, actually, spending time in this kind of way is affecting my concentration in a certain way, or it's supporting my concentration in a certain way, and so on. And as I was mucking up these slides, I was sort of slightly sort of tongue-in-cheek idea of like having like a base level, your base unit is a 10-minute meditation, and then doing rankings of different digital experiences against each other, and go, oh, this game's actually really good for concentration, but it's not that great for embodiment. And this sort of is, I deliberately made these slides as a bit of a provocation, as a bit of a joke, but behind them are some really important ideas and challenges around, as consumers, like at what point is there enough interest for an industry, for developers and designers and providers, and even like, I'm absolutely not advocating this as a regulatory thing, but like at what level of conversation do we need to be at? At the moment, with the digital detox being the center of gravity, it's like, hey, no, just turn everything off and go lie down in a meadow and everything's gonna be fine. I'm much more interested in this idea of how sophisticated would it be if I knew that this certain game that I love actually is really good for compassion, but maybe it's not so great for embodiment, so I need to sort of recognize that, so and still go and play it, but recognize that this is what's happening. And again, we have the data to do this, we just don't have the will. So mindfulness of technology, what I'm sort of the, what I see as a sort of techno-optimist future in working as a practitioner in this space is that I see that we've seen in the last, since the launch of Wii Fit by Nintendo to the launch of Google Fit and Apple HealthKit recently, we've seen an amazing growth in the use of technology to support our physical health. And many of us here will use wearables or running apps or whatever, food tracking or whatever it is. And that's been a really brilliant and exciting trend. And that shift now has to shift into, and I think it is, and it is happening to shift into the realm of mental health and mental well-being and the inner life. And from a design perspective, from a sort of maker perspective, which is where I spend my time at my desk, this idea, sort of another, this idea of awareness-centered design. So the last 10 years of our digital products have been built around this idea of user-centered design. So looking at user behavior, making products, making the first generation of products, and then watching how users use them, and then optimizing products to sort of either monetize them even more or increase experience or engagement or whatever. And I think there's what I'm excited about exploring and practicing and growing a conversation around is this idea of awareness-centered design. So we're explicitly looking at supporting people's inner lives through external products. So I guess my challenge for the room and for myself, constantly and my colleagues, is this decision that what is it we're doing right now that can lead to this future? In the same way that I made a decision that in Wat Pa Nana Chat around committing to this life of stuff and this life of this really messy life of information and technology and work and relationships and I'm totally wholehearted committing to that. But how do we bring how do you really make it work in the midst of it instead of always constantly making it a duality, which I think is an issue that we often a sort of trap we often fall into a bit too much. And so just I wanted to finish for the last couple of minutes just that I've talked a lot about sort of technology and technology design. And as you'll all know, making better technology is only half of the solution. The other half is actually just our own practice. Alongside the doing what you can to support, either from a consumer perspective or from a maker perspective, the more we just have to really up our practice, because the more awareness we have around our own minds. So specifically, if you're looking from a practical perspective, if Vision sort of shared a practice, like my sort of 2-second practice sharing would be around actually, there's a big focus in sort of pop mindfulness around breath and body as object. And I'd really encourage those of you interested to practice a lot more with mind state and awareness itself. Because then if we start looking at the nature of awareness and the nature and actually looking at mind state, then we'll become a lot more sensitive to how everything around us is shifting us around. So it can be a big blind spot for a lot of people that we can be aware of our breath or aware of our body, but behind that there are a lot of attitudes and views that we're not necessarily aware of. And so the more awareness we have, then the better our technologies will become. So that my vision ultimately is that not just that every app becomes a mindfulness app, because we have the skills and we have the technology and the inner practice to be able to relate to everything we experience in our digital lives as an opportunity for calm, compassion, and insight. So thank you.